Hello everyone, this is Natacha Pennycooke. I am here on the Keep6ix Instagram platform. Welcome. Today, this is Wednesday, and you are here locked in live to Keep6ix Connect the Six. This is our IG live program series right here on Keep6ix. Hi everybody. It's great to see so many people who are joining. I am just setting myself up. Can you see me? Can you hear me? My phone's doing some weird things. There you go. That might be better. So today's going to be a special programming. I know last week we had announced who was going to be on. Given the current situation and racial tensions that are going on in the world, we have decided to pivot with that. And today we are going to be talking about coping with the impact of racial trauma. Thank you for telling me that you see me, you hear me. Thank you so much. So we are, no one is immune to what's been going on. Even if you think you might be immune to what's going on, you are not. So we do have a jam-packed show today. And before we get started, today's show is dedicated to Regis Korinsky Pocket. She is the young woman who was unfortunately lost her life while her family had called out for police help with her. So today's show is dedicated to her, to her family, to her friends. I'm going to start by inviting Rachel on. Rachel's my co-host. She's usually see her behind the scenes, so she's going to jump on with me today. Like I said, we have a full show. We're having myself. We're going to be talking about racial trauma. Rachel's going to come in and talk to us about some of her experiences, what she's been doing to be, to live, to cope, to heal with this time. We're having Jason Altidor come in. He's also going to be speaking with us, and then we'll be wrapping up today's show with Richard Miller, founder of Keep6ix. So thank you everyone for being here. Rachel, I'm not sure if you connected, request to join. I'm checking in. So Rachel, if you could do that, that would be great. While we're getting all that ready and getting Rachel up and logged in, I'm just going to shift my computer a little bit. All right, great. So some of you may be asking, you know, what is racial trauma? There's different names for racial trauma. Racial trauma is also referred to race-based stress, race-related stress, racial trauma. Racial trauma refers to a psychological disorder associated with the experiences of racism and discrimination. It includes racial microaggressions, racial discrimination, racial harassment. All of this can have a significant impact on our sense of self, our sense of safety, and our ability to be okay and whole. I'm looking, Rachel. So Rachel has said she's requested to join. I'm letting her. Prisoner advocacy with Keep6ix is joining as we speak.
Can you hear me? I'm not seeing myself.
I can hear you, Rachel. Welcome. I cannot see you.
I'm just trying to see if
I can hear
you. I'm trying to flip my camera, but it's not flipping.
It's not working. All right. Hopefully you can jump on. I just realized I forgot to start my screen recorder. Are you recording, Rachel?
I'm recording, but let me see. Maybe that's what it is. Let me stop it and then see if it works. Oh, okay. Now it works.
Yeah, there you go. It's working. There you are. Hey, Rachel. Thank you. There you go. I just realized I forgot to press record. So are you recording on your end?
So I just stopped it to get in, but let me say it. No, see, when I start screen recording, my screen goes blank.
Okay, well, we're going to cross our fingers and pray that this works for later on. So come back in so we can start our conversation, Rachel. So for those of you who've just joined, thank you so much for joining us today. I am Natacha Pennycooke. We are here talking about the impact of racial trauma. My co-host Rachel is just trying to pop in to join.
There we go.
There we go. Hi, Rachel. Thank you. So, Rachel, how Hello. Have you been doing?
I've been okay. I think what I would say is there's a lot of emotions, similar to what I've spoken to with friends and family as well. There's definitely a lot of different emotions. Some are hard to identify with. Some are emotions that I'm trying to maybe suppress. It's one of those things where it takes time to really realize that you have to embrace all the different feelings and all the different emotions that are currently going on right now. But for the most part, I would say I'm okay. It's definitely a different time, and it takes a lot emotionally, mentally as well. But I'm okay.
Okay. And I agree with you. It is a hard time. People have been asking about how I'm doing, both from a professional side and from a personal side. I think from a personal side, it very much mirrors my professional side, where it's heavy. I'm feeling emotionally exhausted. I'm also tired of this, right? I'm tired of having to be emotionally exhausted, dealing with racial tension, dealing with racial trauma, dealing with the repercussions that come afterwards. And part of those repercussions is that we have conversations like this about how do I cope and how do I heal. I'm at this place and space of, I'm tired of having to cope and having to heal with this, because I'm tired of the racial tension. I'm tired of the trauma. I'm tired of what it does to me and my body. And the thing is, especially doing this work, this emotional work that I do, it's repeated with every client that I see. As you know, most of my clients are Black men and Black women, primarily Black women, Black and Black men. And we're all feeling this. We're all feeling this. So if it's a day where I have four clients for 4 hours, I'm speaking of it and the repercussions I has and how it triggers. And a lot of us are already struggling with anxieties and depression and different things that something like this, it exacerbates everything.
It's so draining.
It's draining. And we've already been going through this with COVID, right? A lot of people, you might recognize that a lot of the feelings that you're feeling probably feels like March while we were in the beginning of COVID. And it's like, okay, I'm chugging along. I'm starting to feel okay. And now all of this, and it's heavier. It piles on. So it's just like layered on top of each other. It's a lot. So that question, right? How am I doing? That's how I'm doing in a nutshell. And it's heavy, it's emotionally draining, and I'm tired of it. I'm tired of it. So Rachel, I know that we spoke on Saturday. You were out downtown Toronto. You were taking part in the march that was taking place. Do you want to tell us from your perspective what that was like for you?
The protest, it was very overwhelming, and not from the standpoint of being outside for hours. That wasn't what was overwhelming. It was the amount of the feelings. Everybody copes differently. Everyone grieves differently. Everyone expresses their emotions differently. And seeing all of those emotions, seeing the hurt, the pain, the anger, it takes a lot to really be able to, as unfortunate it is, unfortunate circumstances that have united the city, really, to come together. It was great to see everyone coming together with thousands of people. But it was also, at the same time, I would say there was anger as well. And the reason why I would say that is, towards the end of the protest, it ended up at police headquarters, which is on College Street. And there was a lot of anger in that there were officers who were laughing or smirking or they weren't, it was a situation that was being taken lightly. And to see the amount of emotion on everybody that's around you and what everyone is fighting for, what everyone's trying to bring awareness to, and then to see these individuals standing in your face and smirking or laughing or shrugging it off or acting as if it's not a serious issue, it just angers you even more. It enrages you even more. And so, because of that, even within the protesters that were there, all of the feelings, those feelings, you feel them as well, right? And everyone's pain's different. Everyone reacts differently. And you saw that, right? Like, I saw that right there being at the forefront, and hearing other people's stories, their experiences. It was a lot. It was a lot. And so, one thing I want to thank you for was for reaching out to me that night and the next morning just to see how I was doing. Was I okay? And for me, I just had to unplug. That was really what I had to do. Because there are so many different emotions, and instead of suppressing those, trying to understand them and acknowledge them, I personally just had to unplug for that day.
Yeah, and that makes complete sense, right? I mean, yes, as you said, communities together, coming together, showing solidarity, showing validation for what we are going through, however, the heaviness of it. And it's heavy because it's not you and just the next person next to you and the other person next to you, but it's all those thousands of people, that collective hurt and collective trauma. It's huge and it's heavy. So me recognizing that, and as we spoke, I know we spoke that afternoon before you went to the vigil, and it was just like, you know, yeah, let me check, let me make it a point to remind myself to check in on you. Because the thing is, you and I, we've been connecting and doing this work, but when we're actually in it feels different, right? Like when we're doing this work, we're removed a little bit. But when you're in it, and it's like being in this bowl, and all the emotion is flooding around you, and it's literally filling you up. So what do you do with this, right? And that's the impact of racial trauma. It completely encompasses you and takes over. And then when something like this happens, not only was a couple of days prior to what happened here in Toronto with Reggie, but then also with George in the States, right? So it's just impacted continuously, and it's a lot.
It is.
And
It is a lot.
it's enough. I know that you mentioned that ended up at the police headquarters. Was that a change in route? Because that wasn't the original plan, if I understand it.
Yes. So I'm not too sure at what point it was communicated per se, but the original endpoint was supposed to be Queen's Park. At some point, we were told that the route was being changed and was going to be going towards police headquarters instead, which is on College Street. And it was because there were rumors that there were actual white supremacist groups that were heading towards Queen's Park. So to keep the protest as peaceful as possible, and to prevent any sort of conflict whatsoever, we were told that it was being rerouted to headquarters instead.
Okay. Yeah, that in and of itself, just like imagining that this was a peaceful protest, it was planned, and then the white supremacist groups that feel the privilege, the entitlement to come out, right? And something like this. I mean, the good thing, I mean, the route was rerouted, but at the same time, it's just like it's the continuous fight to be heard.
It is. It is. And it's like recently there's just been so many things that have been happening. So many we've seen in the States, everything happening within the States, now here within Toronto. And then just for me on Sunday, I unplugged from everything. And then Sunday I went to Walmart and I witnessed somebody telling a Walmart worker to go back to their country. And for me, in my mind, it was like, this is not happening. Like, everything's happening right now, and now this. And I was so enraged and so furious. And I'm a very vocal person, but I'm also a very upfront person. So, yes, I did step to the person. But at that time, there were two young black men that saw and came running. And at that moment, it went from being enraged to being fearful in a split second. Because to me, it was, if anything happens, God forbid, the narrative's going to change completely. And it was that day, it was just so everything I experienced from the day before, and then this experience, I was like, this could be my husband, this could be my brothers, this could be, like, I was like, this isn't real. And I think that's what a lot of people are facing and what a lot of people have been seeing. And it's a lot. It's a lot.
It's a lot as you're speaking, right? Of recognizing how the feeling, and I tell my clients all the time, that we have the capacity as humans to feel a multitude of feelings at the same time. As soon as you mentioned that you saw these two black men running, I felt fear, and I was feeling fear and thinking fear, and you said fear. Because it goes there. It's like, I'm enraged, I'm gonna go do something, I'm gonna go speak out, and then it's like, no, now I'm fearful. It reminds me, I've been seeing, I think it was on, I think it was on Black Moms Connect. Someone posted a picture. This picture was heart-wrenching. It was, I think it was here in Toronto during the protest on a weekend. It was a black mom sitting in the back seat with her black baby. This baby was probably 6, 7 months. And 6, 7 months, looking with joy, look at all the people around, and this mother is clenching her 6-month-year-old, and the fear in her face, right?
It's a lot.
I get emotional about this because I have a son, and it's scary.
Is.
It's scary,
It is. It is.
right? It is scary, and I worry.
Yeah, and I think that's why this conversation is so vital, because there's the mothers who worry when their sons step out or their husbands step out. There's the fathers who worry about how do they protect their families. There's the children that worry when their parents leave. There's so much just trauma in general throughout the entire family, right? So I think that's why this conversation today is so important. Because we have to address how we're feeling, how are we coping with that, and recognize what that is.
And it's that need for healing, right? A step further than coping. I mean, there's surviving and there's coping, but how do we heal from this? And it feels that we are continuously having to ask this question, how do we heal from this? Because this has been something that's been going on, not just last week or the week before, but this has been generations. And when we speak about trauma, we don't only speak about it from a individual perspective, as we know what's going on, that this is a collective trauma. It's also a generational trauma. So not only is it from myself and my past ancestors, but it's from me to you and to everyone out there listening. Right? There, and this is what unites us as Black people. Right, it's a black community of communities. Yes, we may come from different areas throughout the world, throughout the globe, but there's one thing that connects us. It's the racial injustice that we have experienced because of the melanin in our skin.
It is. That is exactly what it is.
I know this has been, it's been heavy, and I just want to know why was it important for you to be there on Saturday? Because you were there for a long time.
Yeah, I left. I think I was a little after 8:30 is when I left. So about a little over 5 hours. But it was just, I couldn't sit at home. I couldn't do it. it was one of those things where it's like I had to be vocal, whether I had someone coming with me or not. And I remember it was one of the things when I was talking to my partner about it. He was like, "You have to," he was just like, "Something could happen." And I said, "No, I've got to be there." It's just something that it was my, I just had to be there in solidarity, show my respects, and also just continue this fight. On the back end, I'm doing a lot of prison advocacy work, but really, it's not just what's going on in the system, within the criminal justice system. It's also happening here. It's happening in the community. It's happening out. It's outright. So it was really important for me to be there, and me being, I was so happy to be there. Just the emotions, but also being able to talk to others, listen to their experiences, and not just within the Black community, but I was able to even speak to Indigenous folks that were there and hear their stories. And I had a gentleman who said, he said, "I've been through these." He's like, "I've been doing this for years." And he was telling me of his own experiences and his mother being killed and his sister being killed and his brother being killed and these same injustices. And it's like gathering and hearing each other's experiences. You're not going to get that. At least I'm not going to get that sitting at home. So I personally, I just, it was what I had to do.
And that's actually one of the biggest ways to cope with racial trauma. It's building community and having community support, because what it does is that there's empathy between us. There's understanding between us. There's validation of our experiences. And especially as peoples who are invalidated a lot throughout our regular everyday to-day life, the fact that you were able to go there, and as you said, you couldn't stay home, and then speaking with different people and people of different walks of life and creeds, and being able to find connection, right? It's absolutely important that you found that connection, because that is healing, right? As we're here talking about coping, I'm going a step further. It's healing, because I resonate with you and you resonate with me, and we can be in this together, and that we can know that we're not doing it alone. Right? We can support each other and be there for one another.
And that's why I appreciate you reaching out, because just those messages that you're sending in terms of be kind to those emotions, unplug if that's what you need to do, self-care, those are all reminders that we need for each other. And so it was important. I mean, I appreciate it, but even for each other to reach out to each other and just check in and say, hey, are you okay?
We have to. Being kind to each other is so important. It's so important. And what happens if you think from a mental health perspective, what happens if we continuously having people who are unkind and unkind and unkind? That becomes an ingrained trauma. And what happens there is then we start being unkind to us, because we've learned how to be to ourselves from the people in our lives. And if continuously what we see in our lives is people being unkind and unjust, we pick that up. So that was my reminder to yourself, to myself, to everyone out there listening. Be kind to yourself, right? If we go into what we're talking about is coping and healing, you need to be kind to yourself to be able to give yourself permission to heal. And if you don't do that, then what happens is you end up treating yourself the way everyone out there is treating you.
It's true.
And we
So
deserve
true.
more. We deserve more than that. Right. So, Rachel, I love always having conversations with you. I appreciate you. I thank you. I'm going to invite Jason Altidor to jump on. Rachel's still going to be around. If you have questions, Rachel's going to be there fielding the questions. Today, like I said, we have a really big show. I'm not sure if we'll get to all the questions, but we will do our best. So, Rachel, thank you. And I know you got my
Thank
back because you're going to
you.
be still around, and I
I'm on
appreciate
the
it.
back
Thank you. So, Jason Decor Altidor, he is a motivator. He is a fitness trainer. He has written a poem called please stop killing us. Jason is a personal family friend of mine. And Jason, I invite you to come on. I'm going to double check. I hope I didn't miss your request to join. For those of you just joining, welcome. We are speaking about coping with the impact of racial trauma today, and I'm just waiting for Jason Altidor to come on. Let's see. Whoops. Sorry about that, everyone. So, oh, Jason, I see it. I'm getting you on. Hey Jay.
Attached.
Hey, how you doing?
I'm doing good. How are you doing?
You're doing good for real? You don't have This is not a place where you have to use your good, okay, fine. You can be real.
Yeah, I'm being real. I mean, I'm as good as I can be, you know. Obviously, we have days where we're better than others. Right now it's really heavy, like we're mentioning earlier. There's just so much going on, and you can't even put your finger on it. It's coming from all angles, and like you mentioned so many good points about coming together as a community. And the main thing is, we always say, don't be silent. Now, everybody worries about, well, if I say something, I'm going to be judged. And it's not a matter of what you're saying, but it's who you're talking to and how can you communicate and understand, because maybe you have the ignorance, maybe you don't know something, and you're not going to understand what the truth is unless you speak out and then have that answered. Maybe the next person, you know, you're a good friend of yours, can answer that for you, or even a stranger, you know? So,
I
yeah.
love those points, and it's true. And a lot of times we do have that fear, right? Because reaching out is scary.
Very, yeah, it really is very,
It's
it's
scary because we think that we're going to be judged and rejected,
yeah.
right? And isolated. So reaching out is scary. So this is one of the times, and this is why community building, this is why allyship is important. So we know who and whom we can go to reach out, to have our backs for that support and solidarity.
Exactly. And the beauty and at the same time the ugly of social media is you see all these things and it becomes too much. I don't want to see this. I turn it off. But at the same time, the same social media is the one that's going to bring you together and bring the community to speak, to put yourself out there and to connect. Because imagine you take all this away, all you have is the people around you. So if you can put this on a global level, then now you're getting the words out. And you might be making more of a difference. And this is where it begins. It's making that difference, making that next step. Because everyone's tired. We're all fed up.
We are. So tell us about your poem. Are you going to read it? Are you going to show the clip? You can I'll leave that to you if you want to read it, if you want to show the clip. I really, you know what? That was so powerful. I know that when you sent it to me, to us, I couldn't watch it right away because I was so raw. So it took me a while to work myself up into watching it. And when I watched it, I said, this is powerful, Jason. That was so powerful. And I literally like sent it to people I know. I have friends all over the world from here in the Toronto area. You, Jason is in Montreal, my hometown. To you in Montreal area, to friends that I have in South Africa. I literally sent it to people all over the world. A girlfriend in Oakland, California as well. So yeah, are you going to read it? You're definitely welcome to show the video that you made, whatever you're comfortable with.
Am going to read it. So I have it in front of me because I was telling Tash earlier, I didn't want to have to kind of, you know, memorize and just kind of stay on the spot. I mean, whatever I'm going to say, I will say, but I do have it there, so I'm going to read it and I'll talk a little bit more about it.
Okay, so
So
give us the
basically,
title and whenever you're ready.
right. So it's called Please Stop. So, dear God, can you hear me? I know I've sinned, but I didn't deserve to be pinned on the neck. This whole system's a wreck. I can't breathe. What if a black man was replaced by a puppy? Tell me what you think. What was that? Animal abuse? That's what I thought. Let that sink. Please stop killing us. No, it's not okay, K. But I'm afraid it is. The skies of the man in blue, they shoot and don't ask questions. Oh, but I thought you knew. They also put you in a chokehold and say it's necessary. Then you're 6 feet under, lying in a cemetery. Here's another story, change of scene. This man was barely the age of 17. 6 feet, 2 inches tall, he stood up. Bullet in the chest, because his hood's up. Please stop killing us. We are sons and daughters, mothers and fathers. We are doctors and lawyers and successful employers. We have passion and dreams. We are kings and queens. We have the ability to be whoever we want to be by all means. They try to break us in pieces, but we'll never shatter because we are black and our lives matter.
Thank you, Jason. Thank you for sharing that. Yeah, that's okay. It's heavy. It's heavy. It's heavy, and it raised so many very valid points and made reference to too many people.
The thing is about it, what keeps going in my head is, you know, the fact is I always see this. I'm always seeing all the news at night, which is probably the worst thing to do is because it's the last thing you think of. And then you wake up with all these thoughts and this anger and this heaviness, and that, you know, the whole world is basically feeling the same thing you're feeling. And it's just continuously seeing that image in my head of the man's knee on the guy's neck. And his body was limp. He was dead on video. You know, they say what they're saying, but he died right there. And you have the cops standing there watching everything happening and not doing anything about it. And all of that just, it was just the tip on the iceberg. It's just, that was the message that said, no, this is it. We had enough. But again, it's been going on for years. We've been saying this all the time. Why did it take this to happen to say, now we got to do something? This is the problem. This is what we need to change. This is what we need to fix.
Yeah. And the thing is, every time this happens to a man, to a woman, to a child, right, we go through this.
Yeah.
Right? And every time it seems like this is going to be the time. This is going to be the time. Right. Until the next time.
Exactly. Right?
And it's a lot. It's a lot.
It's too much. The thing is, you know, you can change your shirt, you can put on a new hat, but your skin's your skin. You wake up in the morning, you go to bed. This is the skin that is always going to remain on you until you're the day you're born to the day you die. And why should your pigmentation dictate how you're treated in this world?
Yeah.
It shouldn't.
Yeah.
It shouldn't.
No, it shouldn't. It shouldn't. And, you know, there's a lot of people who use the narrative that race is a social contract, right? We've heard that, how race is a social contract. And yes, there's some truth in that.
Right.
But when the social contract becomes a day in and a day out and is impacting people the way it does, it's no longer a figmented social contract. It is truth. And it's hurting and it's hard.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. Exactly. What motivated you? I feel like I don't even have to ask this question, but if there's anything else you want to add to that.
I mean, it's funny because what really triggered it, obviously it was just for years, but I was watching a movie and it was a martial arts movie. It's called Ip Man. It was the fourth movie. And a lot of it was racism, but it was towards Asians. So, again, not the same history, but the same story that's happening over and over. And I was angry in the movie. I almost wanted to jump in and be like, hey, like this is what's happening and nothing is being changed about it. Mm-hmm. And something just told me that something has to be said. You know, either way, I was going to say something. But for me, the way I portray and I put myself out there is through poetry. That's the best way that I express myself. And I feel everybody should do the same. Find what's deep inside that allows you to express yourself in whatever way, whatever way is possible. So for some people, it might, you know, knocking at your neighbor's door and just saying, how are you? Just those little acts, it shows the empathy. It shows that you care. It shows that, look, I don't understand something and I'm aware. I hear you. What can I do to help? What can I do to understand better? You know, even if you can't help, understand the history, understand where it comes from. Because again, ignorance is all around us.
Yeah.
So, you know, there's many ways to be motivated.
Yeah. Very true. Very true. What was it like for you to act it out? For those of you who haven't seen, Jason will tell us about his social media handles where you can go and see him acting out this poem. But Jason, how was it for you to act it out?
Well, it happened shortly after I wrote it. So I wrote it first and then I recorded it because I wanted to hear myself. But at the time I was writing, I was filled with a lot of emotion. So that emotion just stayed with me for hours. And I heard it back. I shared it with a few people and I said, this is, for me, it's not enough. I need to put it out there because I need for people to understand how it's coming from, because the words weren't enough, but the visual needed to be that impact. So I just went at it. I just expressed it the best way I could. And I just put it out there.
Yeah. And you did a great job. And definitely when I saw it, I felt it. I felt the rawness, right? The rawness of the feeling in it. Exactly. And the words you were saying. And then also because I know you and I've known you, it hits even harder, right? It hits even harder. Gosh. I was going to ask you another question. I don't have that much time. This is a conversation we could sit and have for longer than we do have. Jason, tell everyone who you are, where they can reach you.
Right. So as Tash mentioned, I'm a motivator and a personal trainer. I'm also a group trainer. My handle is Jason_the_core_Altidor. It's you can see that in the messages, but basically I train people, but I motivate. And what's important about motivation is we always need it, right? And it gets us through our days and it comes from all forms. So for sure, it's always about being active, eating well, sleeping well. And during these times, especially, we need to have our mind-body connection. We need to be on point and we need to be taking care of ourselves, because these are the times where everything is trying to break us down and we need to do everything to keep ourselves standing. You cannot fall, you cannot break. So that's basically what I do.
Yeah. And I love that you mentioned a mind-body connection, because this is something that I do a lot as a psychotherapist. There is a connection. Everyone needs to know there is a connection between your mental health and your physical health. If your mental health is impacted, your physical health is going to be impacted. If your physical health is impacted, your mental health is going to be impacted. Know that they work together in tandem. And I know, Jason, that you mentioned having a hard time sleeping, right? And that's one of the hallmarks of trauma.
Yeah, you're right.
That's one of the hallmarks of trauma, and racial trauma goes into that. So, you know, take care of you, connect. I hope that even having you on this platform today, I hope this has helped to validate what you're experiencing. I see you. I get it. I appreciate you. I appreciate you so much. So much as family.
Family, you know, for years. Yeah.
Exactly. So Jason, I will connect with you maybe later today or tomorrow, but thank you again for being here. Thank you for the support. I appreciate you and we will talk soon.
Thank you, Tash. Talk soon.
Hi, you're welcome. Bye, Jason. So as Jason is logging off, Richard Miller, founder of Keep6ix, he's going to be logging on. The way Jason has been coping with what has been going on for him as a Black man, a Black man living in this time with what things that are going on, he has chosen to express himself in a form of poetry. And that is coping. That is healing. We need to understand that, especially for our Black men that who have been told this narrative of masculinity, that being able to connect so well with what is going on inside in a very expressive form, it's so healing. And we need to support our young Black men, our young Black women, our youth, to be able to help them to fully express themselves with what's going on. What happens with trauma, with anxiety, depression, is that we keep everything inside and it eats away at us. And we don't deserve that. We deserve more. So we need to be able to be there with everyone and to connect and to be able to have these conversations. Because as I said, being able to hold space for one another, being able to communicate with one another, being able to hold community and be in unison with one another, it's validating and it is healing. So Richard Miller, founder of Keep6ix. Hi, I'm good. I'm okay, Richard. How are you?
Good, thanks.
Yeah, thank you so much for being here.
Thank you for having me again.
Oh, you're welcome. Anytime. I mean, you've given me pretty much free rein of doing this IG Live, and I definitely appreciate it. And anytime you want to jump on, you're more than welcome.
Well, you ladies do a tremendous job, and I just want to thank you for your hard work and your contribution that you do. It's remarkable.
Thank you. So, Richard, I wanted to have you on as someone who has personal experience with the police, and I know you talk very openly about your history and everything. I think being able to let us know, first of all, how have you been personally impacted by everything that's going on?
It takes a toll, and I guess over the time period, I'm an individual who's been through the justice system numerous times, and I think after a while you ever hear the old saying that individual keep on telling you the same thing over and over, you start believing it, right? And kind of got to that point. So for me personally, I think I'm open with what's going on in a sense that I've seen it. I've lived it to some extreme. And I've always spoken about it, but it's always been undermined. Mm-hmm. And to the sense of, well, you have no rights or you have no reason to talk about this. You know, so that's the extent of it. I'm deeply touched by what's going on. But in the same token, it's a big change because now we have facts. And to make changes, we always need facts. And the question I always ask, and I contribute to always try to facilitate, is how can we make changes? What can we do? That's the important thing. And over the years, it has made me very, very angry. But the anger itself doesn't really resolve. We don't get to where we want to get. So we have to learn how to contribute our time and our energy into a way that's positive to make changes, right?
Yeah. And I think that's exactly what we're trying to do here, right? Create space so we can help people to heal, so we can help to be a change. And that's always been the platform that you speak of with Keep6ix, to be a platform for change, right? Because it's great to say the words you want change, but I mean, you need action behind it.
Right. Uh-huh. And with what's going on, uh-huh, I really strongly feel that this is a time for us to really speak up and always remember that there was a time in my life, I would fairly to say, that individuals, when I spoke about things that I did not see, you know, when you're taught as a child that this was wrong, and then you have other people trying to tell you, well, no, it's not wrong, it's validated. right? Mm-hmm. And they try to validate you and let's even use the word brainwash you into believing in their theory and so forth, right? So I went through those whole changes myself. And for a number of years, and a lot of people don't realize this, but when you have a system that just continues to break you down, and they say it's a system, and it is a system. And I hear a lot of people over the time when I'm speaking, and people say, well, we need changes in our system. Well, there's never going to be changes in our system because, number one, the system is built to suppress. Right? So if you come across an individual that is not in that mind frame and you're not able to penetrate that individual, well, then you are, they're going to try to continue to break you down. So that's my own personal experience, you know what I mean, when it comes to a situation like that.
Yeah.
This is how I feel and what I've experienced and seen myself. And now it gives me an opportunity to validate, to say, yeah, well, the things that I felt that was wrong, it was wrong. Mm-hmm. Because now you have thousands of other individuals coming out and speaking about the same things that I've spoken about before.
Right. Right. Yes. Yes, exactly. Exactly. And then, you know, it points to the good and the bad. It's good that it's validated now about what you've experienced. However, at the time you experienced it, right? And what happened back then. So it's that two sides right there. And this is what I kind of alluded to. It's like this time, you know, people are marching. We want change. Last time we march and we want change. When does this change come in? And one of the things that I do appreciate about you and Keep6ix is that we are trying to make the change with this platform in the way that we can and that we know how.
Yes. And that's one of the important things. I mean, you're quite aware, and a lot of people who are very close to me or around Keep6ix or in the community is quite aware that I never really imagined for us even to be where we are today. My whole thing was just to speak about the injustice that takes place within our system and to educate our community, right? So, mm-hmm. I mean, it just goes to show and validate again that's something that you have a passion for and something that you want to make changes about. There's other people that feel the same way that you do, right? But you have to be able to connect with those individuals. And that's what it comes down to. It's about believing in yourself and stand up, you know, for what you believe in, right?
Yeah.
And once you're able to do that, you will definitely find other people who are willing to support you and, you know, move forward.
So all the stuff that's been going on here in Toronto and in the States and across the world, do you find that it's triggering?
Very much. It's very much triggering for myself. And due to the fact of my own personal experiences, I remembered there's a lot of, you know, an individual that might not know this, but there was a tactic that our police department used to use. It was called a telephone book treatment. And they would have you interrogation and they would beat you with a telephone book because they wouldn't leave bruises on your body, right? Mm-hmm. I experienced that myself personally, you know, in 13 Division way back. And of course, these things. But the thing about it is that we get to a point in life where we tend to accept these things as a norm, right? Because we are broken down. Like I always say to an individual, and I always say, like, take the time and go to a courtroom proceeding, a bail court, and sit in and listen to it. Listen to the Crown, listen to the judge. They're always breaking down that individual. So that is part of the system itself, right? It suppresses us. And that is the way it's built. And remember something. We always have to keep something in mind. This is something that's 500 years been going on, right? So the system is never broken. The system is built. The school system, the justice system, right across the board. It's built that way. It was built that way. The people that's in there, they are programmed a certain way. You know, they carry on their work in that capacity, right? So what we have to do as a community is sit down and work together and try to figure out how we are able to achieve a greater avenue in life for ourselves moving forward.
Definitely agree 100% that us being able to create an avenue to move forward, it's so important and so vital. And yes, in a lot of Black communities, there's been divisiveness, but we also need to remember there's been a lot of connection. And it's interesting that people will I'll often talk about the narrative of divisiveness and divide and not really talk about the connection. But what I have seen is that people are connecting. People are working together. And this is the narrative that we have to start bringing to the forefront. Because if you think about where does the idea of divide come from, exactly what you spoke about, Richard, the system was built like that.
Right.
To divide us. So we need to really stand strong with each other. We need to push forward that narrative that we are connected. And those are some of the big, big ways on how to cope, to heal with racial trauma, right? We need to be able to build that community support and be emotionally centered in what it is that we are experiencing. That's so important.
Yeah, and I totally agree with you. And you have to remember something. When it comes to trauma is something that we all carry. And it's something that is passed down from generation to generation, right? Yeah. So especially at a time like this, it's a time where we need to come together and look at ourselves from within and try to overcome those difficult times, those trauma that we've experienced, right? Yeah. So that we are able to pass it down to others, mm-hmm. that it doesn't continue. There has to be a time that we have to cut that string.
It's hard. The
perfect time. It's hard.
And
it takes a lot of work.
It does. Yeah. Right? And what that is pulling. Yeah.
That's going to happen in a short period of time. But you have to be able to dedicate yourself to be willing to take that, you know, go down that road.
Yeah, exactly. What you spoke about in the trauma being housed, right? It's called the embodiment of trauma. It's how that trauma and the symptoms of the trauma and like the legacies of slavery as a trauma, how it's been embodied not only in our physical being embodied right now to date, but also within our lineage and our ancestry line. Right, that's within and housed within the body. So when things like this happen, yes, it enrages me, the person today, but it also enrages and it triggers all the other pieces within my body of my ancestors. Right. So it's recognizing that when we speak about racial trauma, yes, it's the what I am feeling and that vicarious trauma, the secondary trauma of what I'm seeing, but it's also triggering the generational, intergenerational traumas that have happened prior. All right. So Richard, when you speak about being able to heal, it's so important that we work on healing so that our next generation, our children, our grandchildren, that we're not passing on hurt and pain, but we're passing on healing.
But, I mean, you have to realize something. We've been doing that for many, many, many years and decades, right?
Yeah.
So, centuries. And centuries, that's right. But on top of it, it has to become a time where we're able to evaluate ourselves so that we are able to make that decision to move forward and do what's necessary to overcome all that trauma, right? Yeah. And be willing to dedicate it to it, right? And that's the first, you know, step, I would say, you know.
Exactly.
That would be feasible.
Yeah, exactly. Well, Richard, thank you so much for coming on. Thank you for creating this platform, Keep6ix.
Thank you.
All right. And also, I know that we've been speaking about, we've been receiving a lot of donations and everything. And I know you wanted to thank everybody, so you can take this moment to do that.
Well, thank you. Yeah. So I just would like to say, personally, I would like to thank all of our followers for all your support, but most of all for your donations. It's been tremendously, the work that we do, it never stops. And we have a wonderful team who dedicate their time and effort and everything else. And whatever donations that, you know, the community have been able to give us, we really do appreciate it. And it helps tremendously with other individuals in the community that's been to the justice system, individuals that is even in their trade, trade seminars and stuff like that, trying to get into the work and trying to change your lives. We really do appreciate it, and we thank you. And don't forget to follow us on June 18th. We'll be having a big Zoom forum regarding police brutality, and that's going to be a hot topic. You don't want to miss that for nothing in the world. So stay tuned to Keep6ix and keep following us and doing what you do. And thank you so much, Natacha, for having me on. And it's been a pleasure.
Thank you, Richard. Thank you so much. Thank you for being here. And we will connect soon.
Thank you. Have a good day.
Bye.
Thank you, everyone. Bless.
So that was Richard from Keep6ix. He has mentioned, you know, we've been getting a lot of donations to Keep6ix. I really, really appreciate that support and that love from everyone. Thank you for Rachel. Rachel, you know, you have my back. You have my 6 as we're doing this live. Jason, thank you so much for being here. Richard, again, I just want to wrap up by giving some coping tips, some healing tips for racial trauma, and kind of doing a quick recap of some of the little tidbits that I gave throughout the show today. So ways to really cope, to heal with racial trauma. First and foremost, be kind and be patient with yourself, okay? Be kind, patient with yourself. Show yourself empathy, show yourself understanding. Be emotionally present. Be able to get to a place of, yes, it's hard. Our emotions are hard. It's so important to be present with them, even though they're hard and even though they're scary. Allow yourself to be present with them. If you need help to be present with them, reach out. There are community supports. You know, create safe space for yourself. Create safe space, whether it's something like this, a platform like this, you have a friend to call, someone to reach out to, going to a march, creating safe space for yourself, because our emotions are hard and heavy. We need safe space for them. Allow yourself to unplug from the news, from social media. If you're finding it's too hard and too heavy, unplug from it. You don't need to be triggered by it constantly, constantly. Build community supports like this, platforms like this, community supports. We need to have each other's back and practice self-love, self-care, and self-compassion. The world out there is unkind. To us, it is important that you be kind to yourself, that you show yourself love, that you show yourself care, that you show yourself compassion. It is vital that you show yourself that so you can start treating yourself with that love. Even if it's not being shown to you from outside, you show it to yourself. It's so important. So today has been a special episode of Connect the 6. Next week, join in. We're going to have Carrie Wilson. She is also a member of Keep6ix. She is a child and youth counselor. We are going to be talking about how to speak with children and youth about racism. It's going to be a show that's going to be another hot topic, as Richard said. So make sure to tune in next week, same time, same place. Sending you love. Good night.